Welcome to Tom Girl, where we talk all things sports, entertainment, fashion, and adventure. Today, we're talking to a woman I have admired for years. Her voice has been featured in numerous commercials, promos, video games, TV shows, movies, and live events for brands including Call of Duty, Fortnite, DreamWorks, ESPN, E, and many, many more. Welcome to the show, voiceover actor extraordinaire, Mara Junot.
I feel like we need a fake studio audience.
I know, right? We'll add that in afterwards.
Okay. Hey there.
Oh, how are you? I'm so excited to talk to you.
Oh, I am so excited to talk to you. Thank you so much for having me. This is exciting.
Well, I've been, you know, Instagram stalking you for years. And of course, no.
Likewise.
Know you anyway, but I haven't seen you in person or even on a phone or anything because of the pandemic for so long. So I've just loved watching how your career has grown and all the success you've had over the last, you know, year. So I'm excited to get to share your story with everybody.
Oh, I'm excited too. Thank you so much.
Well, so being a voiceover actor, I'm sure you get the question a lot when people meet you and you tell them what you do and they're like, oh, where have I heard your voice?
Right.
So let's start out by sharing, like, where would people have heard your voice?
Let's see. Well, if you were an AT&T customer, I just quit AT&T, but if you were an AT&T customer and you ever had to call, actually, I was the voice of Nationwide Directory Assistance. Not that that is even a thing anymore. They finally discontinued it like 2 years ago. But if you called information, you would hear me sounding like this. And also AT&T wireless stores and stuff like that. But then TV-wise, lately you can hear me as the promo voice on Ion Plus, their network, and the news with Shepard Smith. I'm a little more intense. And let's see, I don't have any big commercials or anything running right now. He's the voice of Target's holiday campaign about 2 years ago, selling all that Christmas stuff. And I do a lot of video games. You may have heard me on Fortnite or Call of Duty. Fortnite, I play the villain, Dr. Sloan. Call of Duty, I am Zena. She is French and she is very tough. Let's see, League of Legends, I'm Evelyn, and Genshin Impact, I am Lisa, who's very similar, but she's kind of a better, good version of Evelyn, and
And what about animation? Because you've had some recent big animation announcements.
Yes! Oh my god, it took so long for animation to finally pick up. I feel like I was doing everything but trailers and animation, and that's finally started to change over the past couple of years. Let's see, what is released? Just did a feature film with freaking Kenneth Branagh and William Shatner and Olivia Cooke. It's called Fireheart, and I play Miss Laura Devine. She's a 1940s. I always get that era messed up. But she's a diva jazz singer back in the day and suspected of possibly being an arsonist.
Ooh,
let's see, just last night I was on Teen Titans Go as a guest. I played the female Cy, the cyborg. I'm also Emma's mom on Doug Unplugs. It's a DreamWorks DreamWorks show that is exclusively on Apple Plus. I've done a few things in Madagascar, a little bit Wild. I played Wild Wanda. And oh my god, I'm sure I'm forgetting a couple of things, but yeah, it's been rolling, man.
Yeah.
It's been rolling. I'm excited.
You're everywhere. It's amazing. It's so awesome. Well, there's so much to ask because I know there's so many people are gonna be like, how did she do it? How did she get to where she is? Let's start out by how you made the decision that you were going to like get into voiceover. Where'd you start? Where'd you begin?
Let's see. I would say my very first foray into voiceover unofficially was a gazillion years ago. A friend of mine was a business owner and he was looking for somebody. He just wanted a professional voice for his answering system. And I was like, oh, I could do that. So my hubby at the time, you know, he produced it. And I was just like, you know, thank you for calling, blah, blah, blah. And so I was kind of like, oh, that's kind of fun, you know, but then I kind of dropped in, didn't really think much of it. Years later, I was working a job that I just absolutely hated. I was doing three jobs at once and getting paid for one. And I found out, like, the guy next door at the sister company was getting paid twice as much to do one of the jobs. So that wasn't cool. But I was like a retail, I was like a purchasing agent, a inventory control manager, and a warehouse supervisor at, like, a railroad parts company, and I just wanted to shoot myself every single day. So, at one point, a friend of mine was working at a radio station, and he said, "Hey, there's an opening at the local station. You want to give it a shot?" And I'm like, "Hell yeah!" You know, so they had me come in, and I interviewed, and it looked like I might have a shot. So I got together with my friend, and we just put together a fake radio demo because I didn't know what to do. So I read the weather and played a little REO Speedwagon, you know what I mean?
Oh, can't go wrong with REO Speedwagon.
And so I thought, and the reason I picked REO Speedwagon, by the way, is because it was supposed to be a classic rock station that had the opening. Come to find out, it was the country station. There was four stations in this conglomerate, and it was the country station middays that needed a new DJ. So before I knew it, I became Lisa Logan on C107.5 KCIL, South Louisiana's home for today's best country and the legends. And oh my God, I didn't know how I did that. That's just like baked in. Wow.
Okay. Came out from deep.
Right.
Love it.
So I did that for about almost 8 years. And at that point, I had gotten promoted to being a co-host on the classic rock show, the classic rock station. I was doing a morning show there. I was still doing middays as a country DJ. And then I got also hired to do afternoons on the adult contemporary station. So I was talking all day.
That's like a lot.
It's a lot. Yeah. So, you know, they say it takes 10,000 hours to become a master at anything. So I automatically started getting a lot of practice at just talking literally all freaking day, editing my own audio, doing, you know, 15-second commercials, 30-second, 60-second, getting that timing down. So that actually, a lot of people hate radio when it comes to voiceover because, you know, you get stuck in these kind of polished radio patterns. But for me, it really did kind of help get me the foot in the door for when I finally hauled the hell out of radio because it's crazy and decided, you know, this was the best job that I knew at the time. I got to talk for a living, play music, but I was like, it's time to move on. And then all of a sudden the light bulb hit and it was like, oh, voiceover. I can still use my voice for a living because I literally had always wanted to be an actress when I was a kid, but, you know, as I got older, I was like, I can't deal with this. Everybody's got a cell phone. Everybody's in everybody's business. Like, just nobody has privacy anymore. Like, I don't want that, you know? And people always say, oh, you're on camera. You signed up for it. I'm like, no, I'm not.
Yeah.
So I kind of figured, you know, that acting was a dream that I really wouldn't be able to pursue. And then it just kind of hit me. And I was going to go back to school for, I didn't even know where to start. I was going to go back to school for drama or media broadcasting or something. And, you know, I decided to take the time and money that I would have spent taking all these stupid college courses and geology and things that don't even apply to what I wanted to do and just go hardcore and just immerse myself in the world of voiceover. And so that's what I did. I averaged probably 12 to sometimes 16, 18 hours a day just doing something voiceover related. I'd wake up and I'd, you know, watch the vlogs and podcasts and listen to podcasts while I'm, you know, doing the dishes or on the treadmill. And I'm going to all the top agencies. Who are the big agencies? You know, what a good talent sound like? What does a good demo sound like? What are commercials like? What are promos? And I just started just immersing myself and then started taking, like, affordable courses, you know, where I could. And anytime I booked a little gig here and there, I started off on pay-to-plays because I lived in a small town in South Louisiana and there wasn't a voiceover studios. There really wasn't access to that, even though I wasn't far from New Orleans, which is huge on camera, but doesn't even have a big voiceover presence to this day, as far as I know. So I kind of was on my own in terms of connections and education and didn't have a big budget because when I left radio, I had no savings and no plan. I just knew I had to get the hell out. I just let my OCD take its course and I just started researching, practicing, and then starting to get the coaching because I knew I don't want to practice wrong. You know, I need some pro ears in this game. And that's what I started to kind of get my way in there. And pay to plays are kind of what kicked me off to getting my first clients and learning how to run the business side of everything.
So was most of your research on just watching things on YouTube, and I know you're saying listen to podcasts, or where did you go for Everything. Classes as well?
Classes, I actually started with Edge Studio. I actually was a teacher after a while at Edge Studio for a little bit. David Goldberg and the team were just wonderful. But they just had a really nice, affordable setup. They had a lot of information on their website that was just really thorough. They had practice scripts and, you know, words to time calculators to help you figure out, you know, like how to quote, you know, a 20,000 word project or whatever. I had no idea how to do any of this, what fair rates were, you know, how the union and all that worked or whatever. So I started there with small classes and then started doing like individual coaching with various coaches, you know, who I'd hear a lot about. I made it a practice to, if I'd make a little money, try to put as much as I could, you know, pay the bills, but then try to work toward getting that, you know, Neumann microphone or, you know, more coaching or whatever I could do to kind of just hurry up and get good ASAP. Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what was your first, like, you know, like big job or one where you like got your after card now, but we got that through? Or
I don't remember what got me my SAG card. My first like big job was, it took about a year and a half of like really cranking at it. I became the voice of Oric vacuum cleaners and air purifiers, if you remember that. And I was really perky at the time. And, you know, because that was the thing. I did not know how to use my voice back then. And it's something I'm still working through. You know, like I'm non-binary, I'm mixed race, you know, I'm Louisiana Creole. And so there, my whole life, people have kind of judged the way I speak. You know, you're not white enough, you're not black enough. You know, I always felt a little bit too masculine compared to the voices that I heard on TV. And so I thought that I kind of had to fit into this very particular mold of what I was hearing, right? Because they say, mm-hmm. you know, study what's airing and what's trending to know what's going to work. And so that didn't really sound like me. And as far as I was concerned, I could put it on, but it wasn't really me. So I was always struggling with that, you know, be yourself, and that's what books the gig. And then I was like, but no, it's not, you know.
Yeah.
So my early stuff, you can really hear just a lot of constriction in my voice and just really trying to be polite and friendly and feminine and bleh.
So when was that when you took charge? You just like, you know, took like, I'm going to do this my way, or I'm going to be, you know, be me.
Girl, it's a work in progress. I have to say, I'm still working at it. You know what I mean? Like there's still a lot of times where I catch myself going, all right, is that really, you know, are we really relaxed here? Are we really being ourselves here? Are we just kind of putting it on a little bit, you know, because left to my own devices. I mean, like I said, I'm from South Louisiana. I get rowdy. I'm loud. I'm sloppy with my words. I don't have the best diction when I'm not thinking about it. And so if I just really let myself go, I'm like, they would never put that on the air. But I want to say, you know, the more I got into video games and, you know, you get to explore different characters who have more sass and more personality and more this and that, you know, you get to a point where you're like, screw it, I'll just kind of try me a little bit and see what happens. And then you realize that you get booked again and that people kind of like it. And, you know, like me, I'm like, maybe this is working, you know, but I would be lying if I didn't say it's not something that I'm still like checking myself on, you know, because it's been a lifetime of like being told you're not quite you. You know, I've had agents tell me like, you know, I wasn't black enough, whatever that means. And I've had several other voice talent who have been told the same thing. And I'm going, well, how is it that we're not sounding black when we're all black, but it's somebody else telling us what we're supposed to sound like? So yeah, it's a head trip for sure. But I found the more I just started to let go and have fun and say, you know what, if me comes out, you know, if people seem to react to that. And so I do believe that ultimately you have to trust your voice. You have to trust just that person who you are when you're chilling by yourself with a glass of wine. You know what I mean? That's what people really do connect to. You know, we have enough of the polish. Nobody really likes the polish.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, we want the real.
Right.
Yeah.
The grit.
Well, so you've landed in video games. And I mean, that is just a wonderful world where you can explore so many characters and so many different sides of your personality. So tell us about that and kind of what, you know, things you enjoy about being part of the video game world.
Oh, I love every part about it. I wish it paid a little more. I mean, when you see some of the franchises that we're in and the gazillions of dollars they make, and you're like, oh my God, a session fee, but okay. Yeah. You know, but I'm not that better?
Yeah.
But no, it's such a great escape. You know, it's so cathartic. I mean, I have certain characters, you know, like I'm the new Sindel in Mortal Kombat. And man, you want to get out some frustration. It's the little dominatrix action, man. She's the one. You know? You know, so it's just awesome. And I get to play a lot of really tough, like, leaders and commanders and stuff. And I've never really felt like a leader in my own life. And so to be able to just really channel that and go into that space and feel powerful as a woman, and to know that these characters, when you see the reaction later when the games come out, to realize that these characters are becoming somebody else's hero, that's just huge to me. That's what really feeds me, is realizing, like, not only am I just, you know, goofing off in the booth and actually getting paid for it, like, this is actually inspiring other people. Because I've come to realize you can't, it's very, very difficult to be something if you've never seen it. I really believe that, one, you just have to have at least one person who believes in you and just gives you words of encouragement, anybody. Mm-hmm. But just those few words can make a lifetime of difference. But also, you have to be able to see the dream before you can kind of dream the dream. So yeah. It's really exciting to be in a time now where there's so much diversity in casting, and, you know, trans people being cast and non-binary people being cast. And, like, you know, all of these norms are kind of going out the window, and we're showing people that, yeah, there's more than just this original black and white, very small box that we've been putting everybody into. Mm-hmm. And there's so many flavors now, and people can see themselves in these characters. And so that's super exciting to be a part of.
How do you go about, like, developing those, creating those characters for yourself? Like, would you layer it up, or what's your process?
You know, I wish I had a fancy process. I don't. It sounds kind of lazy, but it's not. I swear. I've spent my whole life really studying people, which is ultimately what, you know, acting is. You know, I was bullied a lot as a child. I was overweight. And like I said, like, being mixed race in the South and stuff, I got picked on kind of from both sides. And so my kind of defense mechanism to kind of deal with that was to try to always put myself in other people's shoes. I'm like, maybe they're bullying me because they're getting beat up at home or whatever it was. Mm-hmm. So I got into the practice of thinking about what it was like to be in somebody else's shoes. And so that really helped me a lot. And so I feel like I already kind of got those 10,000 hours worth of practice from a lifetime of doing that. And of course I take, you know, classes as well, you know, private coaching with different people. But yeah, at the end of the day, that's kind of my process. I get all the information about the character. You know, of course, if the game is something that already exists, I get familiar with the franchise and kind of see the tone of the world. You know, what era is it in? You know, how would a woman act in that at that time or whatever? And, you know, if I can get an illustration, even better, because the illustrations are almost instant for me. If I can see what they look like, I can kind of hear where they probably, you know, how they're holding themselves or what position they are. You know, are they some sort of military leader? You know, so how much would they let themselves go? Or, you know, if they're a princess, then, you know, that tells you a lot too. So mm-hmm. I kind of take all of that data and then just kind of channel from there. That's just kind of what I do. It's not like an official process. I don't have this big roster in my head of, oh, I'm going to mix a little bit of Lucy with Bob. And some people do that. It's great. Yeah. I just don't think about that.
Do you have a favorite character so far that you played?
Oh, you know, it just depends on the day. I'm just still pinching myself that I've had the opportunity to be in this world, to live in LA and to do this. I've just been blessed with some really awesome characters. I mean, Dr. Sloan, she's like one of the lead villains in one of the biggest games out there, Fortnite, you know, and she's a big hit with the fans. And, like, isn't she kind of a bitch? The fact that people respond to her, like, there have been several characters that I thought people were like, oh, God, people are going to kill me, you know, or they're going to hate me. I was, like, in The Walking Dead, and I played Krista in The Walking Dead, and Krista's kind of a brooding character, but she was going through a lot. Like, she was secretly pregnant and hiding that from all these people, and then she didn't want the zombies to know, and blah, blah, blah. So she, like, wasn't the most Krista. Pleasant kid, you know. And that, like, The Walking Dead, that was, like, one of my first, like, big, that was my first, like, big AAA video game franchise, you know. And so I was kind of scared, but I feel like I bring a little bit of myself to all of the characters. Mm-hmm. So it just kind of depends on the day. But I really do there's a special place in my heart with almost every one of them. I know that sounds like a cheesy generic answer, but I swear it's true.
Yeah. And you just, I mean, you broke the animation nut, and that's like the tough nut to crack, right? So right. Everybody in the VO world wants to do animation. And I'm sure you've heard people too. I know when people talk to me about their VO, they're like, yeah. I want to do animation. I do different crazy voices, you know? And
yeah.
Everybody says it's not about the crazy voice. So kind of talk to me about like, what you've discovered about animation and how you got your foot in the door now.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's true. It isn't anymore so much about the crazy voices. Not that that doesn't still exist, but if you're keeping up with modern animation, you'll notice a lot of the big shows, it's the celebrity or the talent's natural voice, or it's not too far from that. There's not a lot of those zany, you know, out of the way characters. And again, not to say there's not room for that, but I wouldn't make that your entire focus when you're going into this. What I would focus on is script analysis. That's something that really took me a long time to learn. When I first started getting animation scripts, when I was looking at it, I'm just like, if you just look at, you know, phrase by phrase what each character is saying, it's not that interesting. It doesn't even seem that funny. And you're going, how the hell do people want, you know? But then you see it put together, and then if you actually listen to people's individual lines, you're like, okay, on its own, that's not hilarious, but together, this is a really great show. And so once I kind of started, I stopped hating the copy so much, because I really did have issue with the copy. I'm just like, this isn't funny, and I don't know how to make this funny. And like, she's just saying, I'm going to the store, you know? But once I really started to really play and look for the funny, you know, there's ways that you can make the funny exist. And not everything is funny, but, you know, compared to video games tend to lean way more toward the dramatic, and then animation is more the funny. So that's not a hard and fast rule, but in general, there's a lot more comedy. So I try to look for the funny now. I go in with a lighter attitude. I try to find moments, you know, if they aren't there, you know, just work with my timing maybe. If something's like, oh, this is kind of funny, but it could be a little funnier if maybe I stumbled a little bit, or, you know, I worked with timing. So I think things like improv classes, I really resisted doing improv for a long time because I'm super introverted, but thank you, pandemic, I got to do it with UCB through Zoom last year, and that really helped a lot. You know, and working with coaches. Coaches will really help you to just find that nuance that you might not have caught just by looking at the words themselves. It takes a while to crack, so you have to be patient. That's another thing, too, I didn't realize about animation. It really is one of the hardest nuts to crack. I heard from a friend who had actually talked to an animation casting director who said, like, yeah, she will hear your voice, like, 10 times, I think, and keep it on a list before, you know, she finally goes, okay, now let's give him a shot. So that's a lot, you know, just to get heard 10 times, let alone remembered, you know what I mean? So it's easy to get discouraged, but you just got to stick with it, you know, you got to stick with it. And bug your agents too if they're not giving you the copy.
Yeah.
I know some people who just, their agents just aren't giving them the opportunity, and you can't do anything with that if you can't get in the door there.
Right, yeah, that's very hard. Yeah. Well, especially since, like you were saying earlier, there's so many celebrities that now found out how amazing animation is, and the rest
like,
of us,
oh,
people are like, no, don't you already have enough?
Like, totally. Like, stay away.
Yeah. Well, another thing I totally admire you for is I totally grew up an E child. Like, E Entertainment Television was like, you know, I love red carpet.
Yes.
I love the fashion. I love the gossip celebrity. Yes. And so you were the first female voice of the E True Hollywood Stories.
Yes.
That's awesome.
Thank you. I'm just amazed that that even happened. That was a really fun run. That was like my first, if I recall, that was kind of my first TV narration, you know, recurring TV narration gig. And so I was like you, I loved the E stuff. And I'm like, oh, no pressure. You know what I mean? But they told me in the beginning, you know, we're kind of trying to go for a different sound. You know, in the past, it's kind of been really promoing, a little more announcery, and we want it to be more natural. So, you know, of course, I'd done all this research. I'd been watching the show. I knew what the last people, you know, guys sounded like. And so I'm like trying to keep that out of my head, but then honor the new direction. But I think that was another moment where my whole more masculine, or so I perceived, persona or voice came into play. I've had a lot of situations like that where clients have been like, you know, we really wanted a guy for this, but you have this authority in your voice, mm-hmm. and this confidence and this you know, gravitas I hear a lot, that made us go with a woman, because we really did want a woman, but we were having trouble finding a lot of women who were able to kind of let go and just get comfortable in that space. So mm-hmm. I think that was what kind of helped me to get there, and it was just wonderful. I got to do I think a season, two seasons, or it might have been just one season, but it was just, it was thrill of a lifetime, you know.
Yeah, that's great. Well, we're all gosh, now I can't talk. I'm like, but you were also the voice of news, and that's very hard to get into as well. So talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, same thing. I was competing with, I think it was nothing but guys. I think there may have been one other woman in the pot from what I heard. And they were really intent on leaning with the guy, you know, route, because that's just kind of what we associate, again, with authority, right? You know, it's just like male authority, news, we're in charge, we got you covered. And so, you know, I tend to put on a little more of my voice of God. I'm a little more intense on the new stuff. But yeah, that's actually what I heard, is that I almost didn't get it. I was kind of in the running. But they were just like, I just don't know if her voice is going to be powerful enough. I had a lot of issues with that. I don't, and you do a lot of promo. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you've experienced this too. But I've heard many times that, you know, there's not as many women in promo because their voices just don't punch through, or this and that. Frankly, I have to blame some of these engineers, because I've heard a lot of my stuff that they've put on the air for various projects, not the news per se, but just different promos that I've done. And almost always they're just burying me in music, I think because they're used to just this really compressed, loud sound. And if they would just kind of put a little compression on my voice, which I've learned to kind of do on the side sometimes, because they're not going to do it for you, you got to do what you got to do to stand out. That has definitely been an issue. But so what happened was they were worried that my voice wasn't going to be powerful enough, strong enough. But apparently, I guess Shep Smith himself went to my website, and I don't know what he heard, but he heard something, probably from a video game character, that changed his mind. He was like, okay, I think she can do this. And so...
That's great.
Thank God I got in.
Yeah. Another good thing for having your own website, right? More marketing,
right.
And get yourself out there.
Yeah. And trusting my true voice. You know, at the end of the day, that's what it came down to, is my true voice is deeper and boomier and louder. And when I just started to embrace that more, these doors are opening up.
Yeah. You definitely know. Another thing I do think we've seen as a plus with the pandemic and the way advertising and promos have shifted is I do think the doors have been opened wider for women and various people to do promo versus just the typical male voice they were used to. I know, like, you know, I'm seeing more female voices in sports, you know, which I'm sure is a goal of yours, as it is with mine, you know, like, and so that's finally really, really encouraging, I think, to see.
Absolutely. Yeah. For several years, I was doing NCAA promos for ESPN. And I still do from time to time. But yeah, that was just such a huge opportunity. And I realized, you know, the magnitude of that, and knowing that there weren't many women behind me. And frankly, there's a lot of different promo opportunities that I've taken on that it wasn't necessarily a dream goal or anything like that. It was more so, I get more turned on by the idea that by me doing this, this is going to open the door for women behind me.
Yeah.
And so I like that, you know, showing people that we can do this.
Yeah. I love that. I read your post that you posted. You had two goals in mind when you started going off after VO full time over a decade ago. So can you tell everybody what those two goals were? And you've been crushing the goals.
Oh, thank you. Well, my first goal was just to be like, I didn't know, like, a ton of voice actors' names at the time. You know, I knew, like, your standard, like, James Earl Jones and Morgan Freeman. And so my initial goal was, like, I'm going to be a female Morgan Freeman. Like, I just want to be a household name working for, like, the biggest Fortune 500 companies in the world. And I want you, you know, when you think of the guys, you know, you also think of somebody like me. And secondly, I really wanted to open those doors and prove to these producers that women can rock the mic just as hard as men if you let them, and if you get out of this mindset that we're supposed to be, you know, female versions of men. You know, we don't have to be. You know, our voices are very powerful. We're like over 51% of the population. Like, we matter. We're bigger consumers in a lot of cases. Like, we should be hearing our own voices speaking back to us. And the fact that we weren't getting those opportunities really bugged me, you know? So I studied, you know, promo training. I took a workshop with you. That's how we first met, you know, years ago. And, you know, trailers and all of that. And I even had managers kind of discourage me, like, you know, have fun with that, but just know it's a really small pool and you'll probably never get in. And I'm like, great, well, I'll be ready when they call, you know, when they do start to think about it. You know, that's what you got to do.
Mm-hmm. Talk about, you also are very vocal about your own health and wellness and some of the battles that you face. And, you know, I know that's a huge part of being ready and being when, you know, having your body and mind set for when you do get those calls. So can you kind of talk about some of these, you know, struggles or battles that you face personally with your health and wellness?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I know some people have mixed opinions on, you know, should you, nobody wants to hear you complain or nobody wants to hear about your problems, but because mental health has been, and frankly, physical health, you know, I have autoimmune disorders as well, has just been such a big part of my life, a big battle in my life day to day and still is. I got tired of people just hush-hushing about it. You know, it's like if you look at the statistics of how many people, just women alone, who are suffering with autoimmune disorders, it's unreal that we're not talking about this every day and that, you know, workplaces aren't doing something to accommodate for this and that our healthcare system isn't talking about this more and trying to find better ways to mitigate this sort of thing. But it's just, we're in this sort of American grind culture where it's just like, go, 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 you know, never let them see you sweat, you know, just always take more, more, more. And it, there's just, finally, we're having these conversations only recently about self-care. Nobody's talking about self-care 5 years ago, you know, and now it's all about, mental wellness and self-care. And it's, I'm so glad to finally see these conversations happening. But they weren't happening for a long time. And I personally felt terrified all the time, you know, like what happens when they find me out? Like what happens when I get too sick? And I always have this kind of inner struggle with success. Like, what if I get too successful and then I can't keep up, you know? Or I get nervous even making appointments too far down the line because I'm like, what if I have a panic attack? Or what if, you know, my autoimmune health is not good? So I was like, damn it, I'm tired of like keeping this in the dark. Like, I bet there's other people going through this because I'm seeing the statistics. And if I scare away a few clients who are like, oh, I don't want to bug her, you know, maybe she's sick, I'm like, so be it. But it was a risk. I felt like I was at a point in my career that I was doing well enough that I could take that risk. If I lose a few people, so be it. But I felt it was more important to put that message out there. And my God, when I do talk about it, and I don't do it every day, but when I do, the floodgates that open in DMs of people saying, me too.
Yeah.
You know? And that's the thing. I wanted to be at the point where we don't have to be like, yeah, that's me too. You know? Where we can say like, yeah, I'm human in America trying to survive in a big city, in an expensive, you know, I'm trying not to be a starving artist, and this is what I'm struggling with. And it's a shame to me that it's not talked about even more, even though I am happy to hear these conversations. So yeah, I try to put that awareness out there, and also to inspire people and show people what's possible, you know, to show people that, look, I deal with, you know, bipolar depression, panic attacks, anxiety disorders, OCD, ADHD. I've been dealing with all these things since I was 10 years old, you know, suicidal tendencies, you know, and then autoimmune disorders that just sometimes kick my ass where I can't get out of bed for a couple of days. And so I'm just trying to show people like, this is the face of that.
Yeah.
And I don't want you to just see my good days, you know, because I hear about that all the time. Is I think it's even becoming a new disorder where people are feeling insecure by watching all people's success on social media, you know?
Sure. A lot of young girls and kids are really struggling with that, for sure.
Big time. And so I'm trying to show, like, yeah, of course, I want casting directors to keep me top of mind, so I post my wins and things like that. But I also want people to see, like, this is life, and I suffer a lot, too. And I'm showing up, but it's not always easy. And I just wanted to show people, you can do it too. If I can freaking get out of this swamp and the swamp of my mind and all this and get to where I have, and like, that's not to say it's not a fight some days and it's not like a big fight some days, but I'm here. And I want to give people hope. If anything, you know, when I'm in the pits of that despair, the one thing that gives me hope is knowing that maybe when I get out of this, I can show people that, you know, this was worth something.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, I just absolutely loved how open and vulnerable you are with it. And like, I was one of those ones that I just told you today, like I struggled with anxiety as well. Yeah. And there's a couple sessions where I've been, was in VO and I just couldn't, you know, having the panic attack. And it's so frightening because you're like, you don't know when it's going to come on. And
right.
Just like, so it is like, can be really just, you know, destabilizing and things. So
totally.
Or crippling. What do you do to get yourself out of those modes, or how have you learned to take care of yourself or try to like handle it all?
I'm finally at a point, and I'm working with a life coach who has to remind me all the time, like, Mara, you don't have to do all the things, you know, anymore. Because when I first started this, you know, I've been doing this full time now for 12 and a half years. And when I first started this, I was just so determined to like show everybody like I can be as good as the boys, you know, don't just hire me for the occasional time you need a black voice. Like, I want you to just hear my voice, know that I'm good, and hire me. And so I tried everything. I did everything. I mean, I like I said, I was voice AT&T, did telephony. I did, you know, corporate narration, industrial narration, local commercials, national commercials, you know, promos, this, that. And I didn't say no to anything. Like, if something came to my inbox, you know, if the rate wasn't great, we'd negotiate or whatever. But I mean, I was like, yes, yes, if I have time, we'll fit it in. Okay. Mm-hmm. And that nearly killed me. I mean, there was one point in my career, just not too long ago, just about 10 years ago, I was working on site with AT&T for this big project for half a year. They had me in New Jersey. And I would wake up in the morning, try to catch up with all my auditions, then record a 4-hour radio show for back home because I was still on the air. So I would voice track a 4-hour radio show, zip off to AT&T for 9 a.m., take care of them until lunchtime, zip back home sometimes for lunch to take care of other auditions or grab a quick cat nap, then come back, work till at AT&T until about 3 o'clock, then zip back home to take care of all the rest of my auditions, any gigs that I had actually booked, take care of that. And then that evening, catch up with my husband. And then like it got so bad, I was literally, from the time I woke up to the time I was going to bed, I was just talking, and I got a vocal nodule and it kicked my ass. And it's like, I went to a speech therapist and they were like, yeah, you need to shut up more.
You need to rest.
You know? And I did not know how to do that because I just had this constant fear of, you know, I don't ever want to be, you know, poor. Like, my mother grew up poor and my grandparents grew up poor and all of this, and you know, people are looking up to me and I can't fail, and I got to break these barriers, and I got to keep up with all these guys who are like, have the golden handcuffs and never leave their studio. I can't say no, because then people will say, well, see, well, we'll just go back to the guy. So I had all these voices in my head saying, keep up with the grind. And I paid the price. You know, I that's when the autoimmune stuff really started to kick in. And before I knew it, like, oh God, like 2018, 2019 kicked my ass. I was passing out sometimes just as much as 4 times a day. There got to a point where I would literally look in my inbox, or a mail would come in, and my brain was so conditioned to like shoot up adrenaline and cortisol in my system when I saw any sign of stress, that I could get a letter that came in the mail and I would pass out. Wow. Like, I was just done. You know?
Yeah.
And it was like, something's gotta give, but I didn't know how to do that because I had branded myself as like, I can do all the things. Mm-hmm. And I had all these agents now who are counting on me, and I'm like, they only get 10% and I gotta feed them. And I'm just putting all this weight on myself. And it finally, it was like, Mary, you can't take care of anything if you're not here. And I was getting to that point where I wasn't going to be here psychologically, everything. Like, I was like, I was ready to like lock me up and throw away the key. I was done. So, you know, I had a lot of talks with the life coach and just a lot of like, where can I scale back? What really doesn't bring me that much passion, but I do it because the money, or why not? Yeah. And I really had to start taking an honest look at, okay, I'm gonna have to let people down more. And once I started doing that, I was really afraid at first, but I started saying my first like, no, sorry, I really don't want to do that, or I don't have time to do that. And I noticed something really weird happened. The more I started saying no, the more things that I wanted to do started showing up. It was like the universe was testing me, you know, just like, you know, okay, I wanted to see if you were gonna pass all that crap, because here's the goodies.
Yeah, making room.
Yeah, you have to make room, you know, because if you keep yourself just in the scarcity mode instead of this abundance mode, and it's easy to do that, you can get very caught up in it, and then you get trapped and you don't know how to get out, because obligation, responsibility, and all this. And that, I was very big on my name. Like, if I'm at, my name's on something, it's going to be the best. And so if I say yes, it's going to be done and fast and blah, blah, blah. And we're humans. You know, we've got the same 24 hours in a day as each other. Nobody has an advantage on that. And we all have limited resources and capacity. And I just finally had to say, you know what? I'm going to focus more on what I want to do. And if somebody gets mad, oh well. And so far, it's been amazing. That doesn't mean I don't still get challenged with that because, you know, life, and this is the sort of business where everything is ASAP, everything is priority, and you know, in promo. So it's like when everything's a priority, nothing's a priority. So it makes it really hard to kind of say what's important today. But beyond that, saying no has been a freaking lifesaver and you have to do it.
Yeah. And then what do you do when you're not in the booth? What are the things that make you happy or what do you enjoy doing?
Naps!
Naps with your kitties, with your cats,
Dude, I'm not even joking. Naps with my cats. Like, if I did not carve out time for naps with my cats, I would not be standing here. Like, my God. Naps with the cats are great. Yeah, we love going to museums, getting out in nature. That's the best for recharging, you know, just traveling a little bit. You know, even just a little road trip to the beach. Just, getting out in the sunshine, spending time with animals and nature. Just seeing something new because we spend a lot of time in this padded room.
Yeah.
You know, no sun. Like, I'm so shiny right now because I have a big, bright light on me because you don't see the light of day.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes for weeks. I literally don't leave the house for weeks sometimes. So you have to do something.
Yeah, for sure. Getting out is important. Well, before I let you go today, I'm sure there's, you know, so many people out there who want to be you. You know, they want your career. They want to get into voiceover. Do you have any tips, you know, words of advice for those folks?
Sure. Number one, be patient. You know, this does not happen overnight. The success that you're seeing right now, I have been planting those seeds for well over a decade, in some cases even more than that, almost two decades. You know what I mean? So be patient and trust the process. Trust yourself. Trust your voice. You know, if there's something about you that you don't like, find out how you can love it more, because it's hard to expect anybody else to love it if you don't love it. Train. You know, don't just practice by yourself. It's great, like, when you're first getting started to practice with peers or whatever you can afford, because it's better than nothing. But you also don't want the wrong ears saying, that sounds amazing, only to find that you've been doing it wrong all this time. So find opportunities to take, you know, acting is key. This is voice acting. It's not just having a great voice. It's about being a good actor first. So find affordable acting opportunities wherever you can. Go to your local university or, you know, talk to people, you know, and see, you know, in the entertainment business that, you know, now that we're online with Zoom everything, you can hire somebody anywhere in the world who might be more affordable than somebody in your own backyard. But definitely get the coaching, practice often, and fall in love with yourself. Because at the end of the day, the more you're in love with this and the more you can just confidently, joyously bring that to this, people are going to hear it, they're going to respond, and you're going to be amazed at what opens up for you.
I love that. That was beautiful. Boom. Mic drop. I love that. It's so true. Because, you know, in the voice, anything you don't like or anything that's, I think I've always felt that anything that's unhealthy or not dealt with in your life, the mic picks it up. You know,
yes,
it knows, you know.
So, yes, it does. We can hear it.
Yeah. Yeah.
We can hear it all. You know, that's all you've got, right? We don't have the visual. So it's all being channeled right there. And everybody's listening to all of those issues. You gotta let it go.
Totally. Do you have any specific classes or private coaches or teacher, anybody that you want to recommend or that have been really helpful for you?
There are so many. I mean, my goodness, like, you know, a commercial, like Mary Lynn Wisner is amazing. Bill Holmes, Elaine Craig. Let's see, my goodness, promo, like Jody Adler, Jeff Howell is phenomenal. Like, I don't want to leave anybody out. There's just so many wonderful people. You know, you can try to hit me up. I'm very slow to respond to DMs, so be patient, but you can hit me up and I'll try to send you a list of resources because I have, you know, a collection of different people I've worked with. But also ask around too. There's a million voiceover groups on Facebook and everywhere else. You know, there's still the VOBB, which is like the oldest standing voiceover. It's a bulletin board, but it's been around for like ever. And, you know, people are still using it. You know, there's so many resources you can get information on who the people that you like are working with. But yeah, you can hit me up. Just
Where can people hit you up at?
I would say Instagram is probably the best. Occasionally Twitter. But yeah, Facebook is the devil. I'm only on Facebook because all of casting seems to still be on Facebook, and like all of the groups and things are still, everybody's like, let me have a group and start it on Facebook. I'm like, why? They're evil. They're selling all our shit, but
No, I'm right there with
it's
you on that one. And what are your handles?
Let's see. Oh, that one's pretty easy. Mara Juno, just about everywhere. TikTok, Instagram, and Twitter. Mara Juno. And don't forget the T, the silent French T.
I absolutely love you, and I just want to
I love
thank
you
you so
too.
much for taking the time today. It's been so great to see your
Oh,
face, and just you're just
likewise.
such a joy and light, and I just look forward to hearing more and more characters. I'm gonna have to go watch Teen Titans Go. Here, yeah. So I'm just so happy for you, and just keep kicking
Thank you.
ass.
Thank you
Yeah.
so much. Thank you so much for this. It's such a pleasure. It's so great to see you.
Well, thank you guys all for listening and watching again. You can follow us everywhere at Tom Girl TV, and we'll look forward to seeing you again next week. Have a good one.
Tom Girl.